Good morning, afternoon, and evening. Welcome back to the Liberal Artist Podcast. I am your host, as ever, scouring the dark web for conservatives and punching them in the nose, Bodio Papula. With me, I have, with lasers in her eyes and ice cream in her hands, Kaylie Horowitz.
My fingers are really cold. Please help me.
And the darkest of Brandons, Andy Gibby Gibson.
You're not ready for the rise of Dark Brandon. I don't know where I am, Jack, but it's gonna get wild.
So Gibby introduced me to this meme like last weekend, and I've been dying ever since. Good job, Bodio. Internet. You did it.
You turned a stupid thing of Let's Go Brandon, which is like just about the dumbest, and it got turned on its head.
We have an inside joke, guys.
Yes, we do. We stole it, and we made Biden the king of shit posts because he forgave some student debt. It's hilarious.
Hey,
that's
money
pretty
is
nice.
Money.
I can't speak for a lot of people, but that's just a game changer for me personally.
Oh my God. I've had so many friends that are like in tears, like to have even if it's not all, like some people have had most of it relieved at this point.
Yeah.
But even if it's not all, just anything.
Right.
Anything
it's the vast majority.
And any little
personally.
Bit is nice. Mm-hmm. Like we are not a political science podcast or anything. We would be vastly underqualified in many facets.
But if you wear a MAGA hat, fuck yourself.
Oh, well, that's pretty obvious. I was talking about like learning everything about socioeconomic reforms and everything. If it's an easy like softball level poli-sci podcast of just like, I'd love to one day punch Ted Cruz in the throat. Like, that's
this
the easy
man
stuff.
Ate my son.
I shouldn't have shown you that bumper sticker.
I've seen it before and it lives in my mind. Rent free, plastered all over the walls. I want like 100 of those stickers and I want to just go absolutely feral at some point and run around Washington, D.C., slapping them on every public
this
building.
This man ate my son.
I cannot wait for the day when somehow, some way, I've ended up in like the nomination for president and Cyber Ted Cruz is also there. And he says,
well, it's
60 years ago, you happened to say that you'd like to punch me in the throat. So much for the tolerant left. And I'm just going to be like, damn it. No,
it's
Fox
gonna be,
News Prime is going to get after me.
It's going to be like Futurama where they just got his head in a jar.
Oh,
and as
God.
Long as there's a neck, you're just going to go, yeah, and I'm going to do it right now.
Don't you have to be like, Bo, you're the Futurama fan here. Don't you have to be culturally relevant or helpful or good in some way for that to be
I don't
like,
know, they
an
keep
option.
The Nixon head around, like, for every other episode.
Because he's the most powerful president of the planet we've
Nixon
ever
becomes
had.
President again, yeah. It's the whole thing.
I love Futurama, specifically President Nixon. Don't chop that up in any soundbite, please. There's only one type of President Nixon that I enjoy, and it's when it's him
and it's
going...
whatever they did to him in Futurama.
Okay, no. So silliness aside, I do have a big announcement.
Okay.
Ooh.
Today was my last day working at my site as a professional dungeon master.
And
not the kinky kind.
Not yet, at least. This was the nerdy kind. This was Dungeons and Dragons. I'm repping the shirt right now that I can't,
ooh,
you know, show because it's not a visual medium. But
again, not yet. It's only a matter of time.
So you got me there. For 8 months, I was a professional Dungeons and Dragons dungeon master. I ran 40 hours a week of games. I ran somewhere over 300 games or so. And may I say this? I'm very tired.
That's a lot of running you did. I feel like your legs would fall off at this point.
Kaylie, do we need to send you home?
Are you okay?
I am. I'm
She
back.
Already is. She already is.
We're all there. Done traveling after the summer. Mm. We're all back where we are it's supposed true. To be until we are freed from our little animal cages and yeah. we break out and invade another area and get into shenanigans.
Shenanigans
and we have to get
ensue.
Thrown back in the proper tank because the aquarium yeah. staff can't have the octopuses eating the other fish.
This is true.
It's a big hassle.
I will interrupt before this metaphor goes any further and more unhinged.
Please do.
Just to say, I enjoyed what I did, but mm-hmm. it's an interesting situation to be in when your dream job becomes your real job, because at the end of the day, it's still a job with all of the ups and downs that comes with. And it's weird. Like yeah. I had talked with some friends this summer. We had all gotten like kind of like the dream job that we had been looking for. And we all just went, huh, you know, after the honeymoon phase, you see the cracks and everything, but you can appreciate the good things about it. And I don't know what my next dream job will be, but I guess we'll find out.
So if anybody's looking for any professional podcasters,
hey.
We got a group right here who are ready to have our dreams dashed.
Yeah, that'll do. That'll be fine right there. I don't know. I'll probably
ready
be a
to have those dreams dashed.
I'll probably be a professional wrestler in like 5 years or something like Ooh. That. Because why the hell not?
The new 5-year timeline. Tell us where you see yourself. Professional wrestling. Oh,
body
okay.
slamming Hangman Adam Page from the top rope for the AEW World Championship.
That's pretty good. That's pretty good, right?
That'd be
there.
Badass. I'd watch that match.
I don't know. I'll probably end up like becoming one of those like a carny backwoods wrestlers who has an audience of 10 people getting paid with a hot dog, but being somehow the happiest man on earth.
There's been a viral.
I want to defeat the giant monkey man and save the ninth dimension.
There's been a viral video of one of those types of wrestlers who his persona, I think, is he's a deranged pizza maker.
Yes, Luigi.
So, nice. Luigi. Nice. Yeah, because of course his name is Luigi. So he's yeah. in the ring flipping dough. Like actively flipping dough while another man on the other side of the ring is in tights. Like, well, how do I approach this man?
You don't. That's the answer. You don't approach this man.
He can actually grapple. Like, he can lock up and do chain wrestling and like trip a guy while he's stretching out the dough. It's incredible. And then to
casually
distract his
approach the pizza.
And then to distract his opponent. He tosses the dough to him and they have to keep trying to spin the dough before he backs up and then drop kicks them and pins them. It is the greatest wrestling gimmick I've seen since Orange Cassidy, whose whole gimmick is that he's hungover and doesn't want to be there.
Imagine what them hands do, though.
You don't want to catch these hands. Don't take the pizza dough off or you're going to get these hands at full force. I got a delivery to make.
The Spider-Man pizza delivery music aggressively yes! plays in the background.
I would kill everyone. Like, I would rip my own eyes out. If this man walks down the ring and is...
Do not try to sing on the same time as a podcast when we're recording remotely. I cannot edit you to be in time with each other.
Do it, editor Gibby. Hey, Editor Gibby, this is when you throw in the Dio the World audio. Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Do another check mark right there for our Zaworldo counter.
Ding.
This is the era where I force Gibby to do things from the past.
Because it's called callbacks, and apparently the algorithm said it's good for a
Editor Gibby, play music from a Donkey Kong Country game.
I was just about to say, we've given up on our new featured Donkey Kong Country song of the month, song of the week,
whatever. I gave that up so long. That was
March. You gave that up immediately.
Yeah, you know what? Because I went back and I played the game and it kicked my ass and I was mad. I have the distance to like recognize that now and I've emotionally processed it, but I was hot at the time. I was genuinely angry.
This has been a year of growth for Gibby, whether it's like the coming and going of a dream job, recognizing anger over video games, discovering a new love of pizza in the wrestling ring. Yeah.
Like, there's so much growth that apparently happens between 25 and a half and 26 and a half that I didn't know about. Like,
that's actually very real.
It is?
Yeah, it is.
Tell us, elder millennial, what happens?
You pay taxes for the first time.
Yeah.
You realize how little money you have, and you try to comprehend if you're happy with that or not.
You truly have to get your own health care and your parents save you.
I was going to say, for me, it's been the like exactly that 25 and a half going, oh God, in 6 months, I'm going to get kicked off health insurance. Oh yeah. God, oh God. And
it's
then
different.
To the like halfway point after 26 going, you know, okay, I'm not dead yet. I might still die, but we've taken the training wheels off and we're a little shaky on what used to be the bicycle, but with training wheels, almost tricycle, quadricycle.
Yeah.
But now it's going.
I don't know. I feel like I've just gotten like a way bigger upscaled big wheel, like a plastic big wheel, like, and I just have to keep making it bigger to keep the illusion going for myself.
I crave a God. Victorian penny farthing bicycle. Impractical.
Yeah.
Massive for no reason other than to be showy.
To stunt.
And it looks really, exactly, it looks really good, like just stunting. Until you have to drive that thing down a cobblestone street and you are shaking the entire way down.
Yeah. You know, it was like having the dream in freshman year of buying a beach cruiser.
Ew.
And then realizing you live on a hilly campus.
It was a good idea at the time.
I'm stopping these metaphors before they go any further.
Let's
start talking about forms of
bicycles.
Transportation. We're done here.
Cool.
Hard transition.
Can we talk about the fighty movies?
Yeah, let's talk about Kung Fu movies.
So there's not a segue of like a Kung Fu movie that uses a bicycle, is there?
There's got to be a Jackie Chan movie.
Jackie Chan fights somebody on a bike in, I think, around the world in 80 days, question mark.
That sounds accurate.
Don't fact check me on that. Shut up, internet.
But I also, it sounds believable, you know? Like,
yes.
Look, any situation
like
where you put
Trump's
Jackie Chan.
Save us all.
Oh my God.
I'm sorry. I don't need that voice line out on the internet. I'm sorry.
Yeah. We're in trouble. I'm in trouble for Nixon stuff. At least I'm not the Trump supporter that Bo apparently is. Kaylee, you got any terrible right-wing takes that you want put on the internet forever?
No.
Good. All right, cool.
I was trying to think of something clever and I could not. So just
good.
No.
It's for the
Kung
best.
Kung Fu movies. I fucking love these.
Again, it's our podcast. You get to listen to what we want to talk about. We're glad you're here. Sit down.
In my ever-expanding repertoire of forcing my friends to watch things that I enjoy, Gibby and I had a conversation about talking about Kung Fu flicks. Gibby was like, I've seen like two of these, and I said, my dude, I have a list. And then Kaylee got caught in the crossfire.
I did, but you know.
I know that, like, me and Kaylee have watched a few here or there, but I want to know about you growing up with Kung Fu movies before we get into the full shebang of, like, what makes a Kung Fu movie? How did they start? Where there's some good ones?
We're not doing a fucking history lesson.
We're not doing a full history lesson. I was going to drop a sentence, but more importantly, I want to know about, like, you,
me,
as a young kid with Kung Fu movie DVDs that you get from your neighbors and randomly that come on TV on local access channels.
You mean that I steal from Movie Gallery from time to time?
Dude, when Movie Gallery comes back after being bankrupt for several years, you're going to be in big trouble.
Good. I paid for Blockbuster, assholes.
So tell us.
Nah, dude. I fucking love Kung Fu flicks. I don't know what else to say.
What's the first one you saw? How was it culturally relevant to you and your brothers and everybody growing up?
The first one I ever saw. That my earliest memory of a Kung Fu movie is the scene. I don't remember what movie it is. It's Bruce Lee versus Chuck Norris.
Okay, I think that's not Enter the Dragon. I think it's the other dragon one.
The Way of the Dragon.
Way of the Dragon. The Dragon.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And watching a scene that was just like two dudes going at it, like dissecting each other. So much to the point where Bruce Lee is like ripping out Chuck Norris's chest hair just because he can't knock this dude over.
Yes.
I thought it was cool. And from there, you know, I rush and discover more and more, and you eventually run into parody and like kung fu action comedies, which leads you into the world of Jackie Chan. And this was like in the late 90s, so he was still very active. But yeah, that's where it started for me, to the point to where now I think I've seen like all three Ip Man movies like four times each.
Wow.
That's an exaggeration. I've seen the first one four times.
And the second, and you know,
the others maybe two or three, but still.
Still, that's a pretty good rewatch right there.
The first three. I think there's more than three. I can't remember. But what do you two think of, like what's the general perception of like kung fu movies and kung fu action and stuff like that? Kaylee, you look like you're about to explode with something to say.
I'm embarrassed, more or less. Partly because like this is not a genre that I grew up with in any way, shape, or form. If anything, I got a lot of the sort of distilled after effects of some of these early kung fu movies and their impact on pop culture and as sort of a cultural currency, as far as like copying scenes or lines or paying homage in some way. Because for me, I think my like earliest memory of like kung fu movie Brenda Song and Wendy Wu,
I'm
Homecoming
so
Warrior.
I'm so angry.
It's a good movie for a DCOM. It's a good movie.
I might have been mad too, but like I had a crush on her as a kid, so I'll let it slide.
Right.
It's whatever. It's all good. That is a choice for your first, I might say.
You know, like but
it was incidental that it was a kung fu movie because you were watching it because it was a Disney Channel original movie.
Yeah, no, like that's the thing. And this was her like seeing in like later interviews that she's done more recently where like that was one of the first times where they had given her a pretty significant amount of creative control and being like, I want to tell this story of like the Asian American experience in this way of like living between two worlds. But in this case, it becoming more fantastical when there's like a whole magic curse thing that we've got to stop. And also like the fantasy kind of like a Jackie Chan style of kung fu and fighting more than like strict, like this is a martial art element. For a while, it was like, oh, it's an action movie. I know what those are. But like this was a marker for me of like, no, this is significantly different. I don't know all the context for it because we don't watch Bruce Lee movies in this house. Like
those are violent.
I mean, you know,
and
like
full of Oriental witchcraft.
I think this was some of the stuff that like my
it was
like,
the '90s. People said shit like that.
Yeah, no, yeah. Like I think these were things that my dad may have seen like in college, like because that was the thing he did. But it wasn't a like, oh yeah, my parents like were into this media and so pushed it upon me and my brother. Like no, that was not the case with this. But honestly, like as far as live action goes, like Around the World in 80 Days, kinda sorta, and Wendy Wu are my two sort of like touchstones of like earliest understanding of like kung fu as its own form under the umbrella of action movie.
Yeah.
But because I live and breathe animation more than live action, Kung Fu Panda is also very up there, and that one is a very intentional like we wanted to do an animated kung fu storyline and be able to express a lot of the mythological and fantastical elements that continue to get passed down in kung fu like storylines through some of the more like the benefits of animation and using like animals as characters and what that embodies and expresses, and how you really, especially for a fighting form that borrows a lot of names of styles or forms from the natural world, in some way, to be able to express like, what does it look like when a literal crane is doing some of these moves, or an actual tiger, like, so like some very exciting
Kung
stuff
Fu Panda is very much so a love letter to Chinese cinema and Kung Fu flicks,
which you would not have expected, you know, for like to be able to like appeal to a crowd that respects, you know, Chinese and Hong Kong cinema history, but also Jack Black's a panda. Like, you wouldn't expect that.
It's been sort of what's made the Chinese animation market realize they've been playing catch up for the last 10-15 years, is that like not embarrassing, but also like when you're trying to capitalize culturally on where people's attention is as far as who's telling stories, it's hard to make up that ground when the American studio does actually a pretty damn good job. And I guess I will say, before we go any further, like talking in like the sort of like kung fu movie, like unpacking, what have you, we are all very American.
That's true.
Even if it, like, I can't speak for Bodio coming from a background of family not from this country within the last generation, but at least for me and Gibby, we are also very ingrained in like Americanness. So
accurate.
I've tried to do a bit of digging and research from like creators and YouTube channels and other places with that sort of Hong Kong, or at least just like Chinese or Asian background, to kind of explain a bit more detail of some of the stuff in kung fu movies. So the best I can say that we have to offer is that an analysis and a dive, and maybe just more of a consideration of these things as pieces of art rather than just media to be consumed. But these are certainly not all things that our backgrounds have like made. And I don't know, I feel
we
like
are not
some...
the experts. This is not our culture. We are just doing our best to be respectful and to enjoy the media. You want to know what my first exposure to kung fu was?
I'm scared, but I want to know.
Jackie Chan Adventures.
Yeah, on Kids WB.
Kids WB up in this boy. Yeah, I saw it when I was about 6, and I just went, I want to do that. I want not just like film or animation.
Jackie Chan.
Yeah, it was just like, I want to be Jackie Chan, because beyond all of the like mystical elements of the show or the 20,000 MacGuffins here or there, I just loved the energy of a hero who wasn't the gigantic guy, who wasn't like picking fights with people. And I think it still prevails to this day that I love the energy of the archetypical Jackie Chan who just goes, sorry, I'll bring this back later, whenever he like takes somebody's wheelchair or bike to include it in a fight. When I was a kid, I just thought that was the most creative thing ever. I didn't go out and seek out a lot of kung fu movies, although I enjoyed them whenever I happened to see them. But kung fu was in all of, well, in a lot of the media I enjoyed.
Oh yeah.
Animation, action, even comedic stuff, and it's really cool to look back now as a media consumer and critic to be like, that's that, and I didn't even realize. So that was my introduction to the genre, and then I watched Everything Everywhere All at Once this summer, and only later was like, oh, this isn't a superhero film, it's a kung fu film.
But it also kind of is.
True.
You also mentioned mentioning the Jackie Chan series, immediately like just made me go, oh, American Dragon Jake Long, like, again, not fully like wants to be kung fu, but certainly kind of borrows moments where, even though this is a fantastical like boy who turns into a dragon.
Yeah.
There's a lot of like nice like hand-to-hand martial artwork in the animation of that show.
So, what's the next question, Bo?
Yeah, motherfucker, don't set me up. No, we're gonna.
I'm setting you up so you can spike it.
I host this podcast. I'll tell you what. I'm sorry.
I can take it out. I'm the editor. God damn it!
I'm just here to have a good time.
Editor Gibby, put in some dope music. Put in like the opening sting for Rush Hour.
All right, that's fine.
You know, I actually have to do that. I think we'll get sued for that. I don't know.
As long as it's less than 30 seconds, you're good to go.
Excellent.
Probably.
Lint, maybe. let's talk about some specific examples. Gibby, I gave you a little bit of homework. Is there like any movie that like you really enjoyed or that like popped out to you?
Primarily the ones that I watched out of your recommended list. The two that I caught in full were Enter the Dragon and Police Story.
The classics.
I've watched some of Rush Hour as well as a lot of other movies that I might cite here or there. Mm. But I feel like when you think kung fu movies, you primarily think Bruce Lee, Jackie Chan, and those were the two movies that are probably the most exemplary of their style and their careers. And I have fairly strong feelings about both of them.
Ooh.
So Enter the Dragon is unique in its time frame because it came out, you know, in the early 70s, where we have a lot of the influence of Hong Kong cinema, but then we also get weird 70s stuff. I did not expect there to just to be straight up funk music going on in scene transitions. I was also not expecting there to be just like, here's a sexy dude, and here's the 12 women that are with him, like, as we have a coy transition here or there, as well as, like, ripple effect to transition between scenes of important backstory. And finally, like, the other 70s thing was just like, oh, slow motion is starting to get accessible. Mm-hmm. Let's do that. Like, there's a lot of things in the time period that I was like, huh. This is really 70s, right? Here.
Yeah. It's a delightful mess of a movie. I'm going to be good.
It is so fucking weird to watch it as compared to any action movie today because it spends like the first 30 minutes either Bruce Lee is demonstrating a principle of kung fu or other characters are getting all of their backstories out immediately.
Yeah.
And then eventually we get to the plot. It was fucking weird to be like, okay, we're on like a Chinese junk ship. We're going to the island. And then up, the golfer guy has to have a backstory. We got to fit that in too. But like past all the weird elements, I really like how formative it feels, because I think from like the more serious kung fu action stuff, that influences everything. The way that they show action on camera, the way that they put the importance of the art and martial artistry in center focus, like just the way that they would showcase Bruce Lee when he was like flexing and he just shows off like full chest before like chopping somebody in the throat. You see the classic signs of like the classic pics of him with like a bloody claw having gone across his chest. And he's just like, come at me, motherfucker. I'm focused. I'm smaller than you, but I can kill you with like three punches. And then he does it.
Yeah,
it's fucking badass and it's weird, but it's badass.
A quick cap off, and this will lead into a different part of the discussion.
Mm-hmm.
If you're confused about what Enter the Dragon is or what it is, if you're vaguely familiar with the quote-unquote plot of Mortal Kombat, that's what it is. We got a bunch of dudes who can fight each other. We put them on an island. There's one
tournament.
Big evil dude. Yeah, there's one big evil dude, and Bruce Lee is going to kick his butt.
Yeah, It is.
That's the movie.
If you go and watch it, it feels cliche, but the only reason it does is because it's the original. That, yes. Like, everybody bases their stuff. There was a goddamn SpongeBob episode, yes, about Karate Island, yep, that Karate has the exact Island same format. Sandy's even wearing the yellow, like, jumpsuit, mm-hmm, that Bruce, yep, Lee wears.
It's the direct it's a direct parody of Enter the Dragon, right? Any hilarious kind of, we go to an island to have a kung fu tournament, that's Enter the Dragon.
It's wild. It's anytime so cool. There's like a slow-mo fight sequence,
uh-huh,
it's Enter the Dragon, I'm pretty sure. I don't know, yep, much more slow-mo fight sequences that would have been there before.
There's a lot after.
Oh, a shit ton after.
Funny thing, I did a bunch more film research. I did the, yes, history research.
Give me
this
the good
time
stuff.
Okay. But it is because of Bruce Lee that we start, one, changing the genre, changing the form. Hong Kong cinema or Chinese cinema, again, I'm not sure specifically which origin, but the media that at least Hong Kong was working with at, mm-hmm, the time was very inspired still by a lot of Chinese opera and stage, yep, technique. So that was referred to as wuxia, if I'm pronouncing,
yes,
this correctly.
Yes, you are.
Okay. But it's big sweeping motions. It's big moment happens, then big moment happens, and your brain's filling in those gaps of the fighting.
It's a little bit more mystical for wuxia.
Yeah, there's big jumps and leaps, and you're making those connections of something hit something in this moment. And we do big wide shots where we see the main character or the antagonist like do something, and everyone reacts to it. Bruce Lee comes in, starts doing things. He has real world fighting experience.
His own martial art.
Yeah, like on top of his own just charisma and identity put into his form, they jokingly kind of call him three kick Lee, I think. Because of the just short, choppy nature, where he's like, one, real fighting doesn't last this long, and two, like, it was just sort of like his style, his form, that they start tightening the shots and chopping them together faster, so that you get all of these tighter, like, one, two, three, cut to the other side, seeing the reaction, whatever the response is, another one, two, three, like, and so on and so forth. So we lose the big wide shot. Yeah, like, and you see over the course of his movies, we start losing those big wide shots, and we get tighter and tighter, and we're starting to do a little bit more choppy editing, but we're also seeing impact as opposed to just, like, imagining where that goes in between the editing.
Yeah.
And in his work in Green Hornet, like, part of the reason he was in that was because he moved so fast that he was a blur on camera, and so the slow motion eventually was this, like, can we see what he's doing? Like, how do we start to try to see this in any form of, like, comprehensible visual understanding because of how fast this man was? Eventually leading into Enter the Dragon, where we finally get a, like, slow motion shot
and then he
of
died.
Some of this work in action. And then, yeah, the sad part.
it's the difficult part of, like, you know, the early 70s, unfortunate trend, late 60s, early 70s of cultural touchstone people and artists who died young, and we couldn't see their full library expand. We couldn't see their full, I don't want to say potential, because these guys were masters, but they didn't get to live to see their full cultural impact, which is really sad to me.
Well, a couple of them did.
Well, I'm talking about the ones that, you know, died, like your Hendrixes, your Jimmy, your Janis
Joplins. Oh, sure,
we're opening
it up, understood.
Yeah, yeah, like a lot of those people who didn't get to see at the time how much impact they would have on future generations. Mm-hmm. Bruce Lee is one of those that makes me the saddest because, as we'll talk about later, his ripples throughout the motion picture art is difficult to comprehend till you look at it from far away.
Yeah. And you realize he was dead the whole time.
Yeah.
The ripples of his work and the ripples of his muscles.
Yeah. Holy shit, that guy was fucking ripped. This is a very brief story, but a journalist, a journalist who was a friend of his was out on a run. They had gone like 5 miles at a quick pace. And Gross. He said, Bruce, if we keep running any further, I think I'm going to die. And Bruce looks at him and goes, then die. And it pissed off the journalist. It pissed him off so much that they ran like 3 or 4 more miles. And he's just like, fuck you. You can't stop me.
Then dive. Bruce!
And die.
What a friendship. What a... Can you... I'm not that friend. I can only hope to be. But like, for me, that would be entering my villain arc.
It turns out that like the secret of Jeet Kune Do is actually pettiness and savagery.
I feel like that's so much of like human survival or just like revenge stories. It's just like you hang on to petty and spite long enough to see it like fulfilled.
Blossom into the ugly corpse flower that it is.
Yes! Stinky plant.
Excellent. Gross. So... yeah, that's probably the briefest summary we could ever give of Bruce Lee.
Yeah. Kaylee, I know you were talking. Your biggest foray into Kung Fu movies is probably one of the most recent ones, Shang-Chi, right?
Speaking of other things, kind of on this, like, I'm picking up this. Y'all are like diving into like the main course. I'm like sweeping up the crumbs on the fringe, basically, of impact. But Shang-Chi is a very interesting case of like, what is it? Because Marvel does like to run with a particular vibe for its movies, or, you know, at least in my opinion, the ones that are like competently directed.
Got him.
Like the
every
reason,
third one.
Yeah, like the reason that Winter Soldier sticks so good is because there was a lot of like thought and planning into the mood, the tone, the structure, and the like reveals of everything. They went very spy thriller. Shang-Chi obviously was like, we're drawing a lot from Kung Fu in this. As well as just other very specific usage and like intentional usage of different forms of martial arts, the techniques, like a lot of detail in that movie and the way that those actors and stunt performers went through that training work. But it's a very, it's really interesting because you're watching some scenes, like there's a big fight on a bus in San Francisco right near the top of the movie that feels very much like could have been ripped right out of a Kung Fu movie because especially later Kung Fu movies, like, and because of Bruce Lee, who starts these kind of weird, like, the first 30 minutes of the movie aren't really fighting, but, like, sometimes it's backstory, sometimes it's just getting the gags and the humor out of the way, because that's who he was as a person, like, he wanted that balance of fighting and funny, so a lot of later Kung Fu movies really dive into the humor of it. Shang-Chi's no exception of playing with tense action and comedy, but then it's a like, oh, now we've got to do the superhero things.
Magic and such.
Magic!
God damn it. You were talking about Winter Soldier, and you know why combat used to be better in Marvel movies and action sequences used to be better? Because they were doing fucking fight choreography.
Yes.
They practiced fight choreography. It wasn't just a guy in front of a green screen with a harness
that
went,
shoot the lasers.
Whoa! Yeah. Like, when you have good action, like, that you practice and it looks real because it's fucking real.
Which is so ironic because it's like we were talking about with Wu Jai. Kung Fu movies were a direct rejection of that style, kind of, not so much green screen because they didn't have green screen in like the 50s, but dudes on wires flying around, shaky cam.
Tell me at least like 60% of Shang-Chi is like the good style of action, and it's not just green screen blast 'em up
sky laser.
And it's also been a while since I've watched this at this point, but it's, I don't know if it's exactly 60. I think it's close because it's the weird, like, then we enter a magical land that again is like borrowing some ideas from like Kung Fu and earlier Wuxia, which are already borrowing from fables and all kinds of mythology of like the creatures that exist here and like the whole feel of this location. Feels like in some ways another homage or at least other nods to things.
At but least the Chinese culture.
Yeah, but then it's like, but we have to green screen these. And so then there's the question of like, well, then which parts are the like fist to fist fightings? And then what is being CG'd behind? But I will say that like, it has that kind of tangibility. That close hand-to-hand combat of these like actual like kung fu pieces of art in some ways like do have
you know what's a pretty good like balance of that for a modern movie that I didn't originally like that's a kung fu movie the fucking Matrix.
I know kung fu.
Show me.
Yeah.
Matrix has so much good like balance of like here's action that is happening that the actors are actually performing while being able to balance like that more mystical Chinese style of showing, you know, kung fu and martial arts on camera because they're in a big computer and everything.
Right.
Like, and there's a billion Agent Smiths who are ready to fight and stare really weirdly at people. But like, they practice and they showcase action that people have had to choreograph and people have had to practice, and real things look good on camera. I don't know how to tell Hollywood this, but practical effects and combat that you've practiced and had choreographed looks better than CGI ever fucking will. And
Gibby, that's expensive.
I know it's expensive. It's better. And they wouldn't have to ruin the lives of like 100 VFX artists at a time because they keep doing that. That's a whole different tangent. Like,
we could just not pay people to make VFX.
What if we get our effects and we don't pay you?
Yeah.
And then we blame you for the movie being bad, despite the fact that we overworked you and underpaid you.
Yeah, idiot.
Insert the frickin' the trade offer meme. I get movie, you get no money.
No money, no credit, and lots of stress. I don't want to talk about CGI. You know what I want to talk about?
Rush Hour.
That's also something good to talk about.
I like Rush Hour.
Tell me about Rush Hour.
Yeah, so Rush Hour, one of my favorite movies of all time.
Yeah,
is the other we went into this with like specific examples, but the balance of comedy and action.
Yeah.
Whereas Bruce Lee and his movies leaned heavier into the action. Actors, the most prolific of those being Jackie Chan, especially once he came over to Hollywood in the U.S. in the 90s and 2000s. Was just what if we just made action comedies?
What if, what if we just made it
humor,
funny?
The whole joke, yeah. The humor is the point, right?
Yeah.
But we follow it up, and
and they printed billions,
and they printed money, bro.
Why didn't I think of that?
Shaking the money tree for every leaf, dude. But no, Rush Hour is one of those movies. It's in the top, in my top three movies of all time.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think it's aged quite as well as I like to think
it's,
it has.
It's early 2000s. You know what you're cracking open.
It's like 97.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah, Rush Hour's old.
Oh, dang. Dang. Well, that vibe of like, we shouldn't say this, but we're gonna. Because we're not gonna get in trouble yet. Just a finger wagged.
Right. It's 98. It's 1998.
Mm.
But we've talked about Jackie Chan already. Because how can you talk about kung fu flicks and not talk about Jackie Chan?
Yeah. Like, but
Yeah,
really Jackie Chan. He really the balance between using the impact, right, the delivery, impact and landing of kung fu and translating that into humor.
Reaction.
Right? How he takes a quote unquote punch to the face, his head flings back, the other guy moves, and then he takes the time to react, whether it's he makes a funny face or he does a flip through a table and comes up and fights the guy with a couple of kitchen utensils or a chair or whatever, right? Really taking that with the physicality that he was capable of. Him and his stunt doubles. Let me put that out there. Every kung fu dude you've ever seen, yes, they do their own stunts and they have stunt doubles because, hey, making movies is hard.
Yeah.
Sometimes you have to fall off a building 6 times to get the cut, right?
Don't ask one guy to do that. For 30 minutes.
just because, like, Tom Cruise has been blessed by, like, Lord Xenu of Scientology and, like, has indestructible bones does not mean that all your favorite actors do.
Right. And even Tom Cruise has a stunt double. And shout out stunt people.
Yeah, they y'all work so work. Fucking hard. That is an incredibly dangerous profession with no thanks.
Until today. Thank you.
Yeah. This will definitely make up for it. But
I just love that combination of taking two seemingly opposite ideas of violence and humor and like mashing them together.
So what do you think, based on like the tenets of like what makes a kung fu movie, what do you think makes Rush Hour a good kung fu movie?
If you ask me, not a Chinese person, I do think if you're not going to have someone who is Chinese or to definitely make sure you pay homage to China and Chinese culture.
Yeah.
Because you kind of have to acknowledge, hey, this is where it's coming from. This will bleed into our next topic. But,
yeah,
you know, they have the dojo, which isn't right. I should call it something different because dojo is specifically Japanese. But the dojo in Matrix. You have, what's her name? I forget Uma Thurman's character's name in Kill Bill.
Uma Thurman.
Uma Thurman's teacher in Kill Bill.
Is that Lucy Liu?
Liu is an actor.
No. No, like, I mean, is the character played by Lucy Liu? Or I haven't seen Kill Bill, so.
No, he's a man. I'm surprised you haven't seen
Kill Bill.
You can only watch so much Tarantino before you become Tarantino, and
that's
I'm scared
fair.
To hit that limit.
Don't want to hit your quota.
But feet.
Yeah, exactly.
And then you get to make yourself say the N-word and tell everybody to suck it.
Another episode, different episode. But anyways.
But no, I think first off is respect to where it comes from.
Mm-hmm.
And number two is just the emphasis on the physicality of the actors.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not only like a respect for them and what they're capable of, but also the physicality is extremely important.
Yeah.
In everything, everywhere, all at once. Half of the movie is just Michelle Yeoh doing badass stuff. And us like sitting on that, right? Just watching her flip a sign, whether it's flip a sign. Or stop a guy from committing anal sex on himself. God, that movie's weird.
It's so fucking good.
It's pretty solid. It's just really, it's mostly just paying respect to what it comes from. And then a real big emphasis on physicality, I think, are the biggest things.
Before we move on to our next segue, I want to just make a brief mention for just an overall look at Jackie Chan. Physicality, like you said, the strike, the impact, the reaction is what makes so many of his action movies, Police Story included, so much better than the majority of American action films because they won't stop cutting 20 times in a goddamn fight. They keep cutting the camera and picking a different shot, and nobody ever gets to see the impact, We just see Liam Neeson jump over a fence with 30 cuts.
Right, but that is to hide the lack of physicality of not saying that these jacked dudes can't do stuff. Right?
They don't. Have you seen the behind the scenes of Jackie Chan taking 100 takes to get one stunt right? Chris Evans isn't doing that. He's a nice guy. He's not doing that.
Get roasted.
Don't.
Get rotated.
Lightly roasted with care.
Yes.
And salted.
Yeah.
Tasty, tasty almonds.
And the difficult thing is that, like, every frame of painting opened my eyes to this later on in his career, you know, getting more with the American cinema style and everything. You know, Jackie Chan eventually has to kowtow a little bit to the Hollywood editing style, and his movies change, and we don't get to see that same crispness of action. We don't get to focus on one shot for a while, which takes away the impact and the magic that he has in a lot of his early work, both like Hong Kong and American movies included. Like, that's a criticism of the style of editing, like of the last like 20 years in general. But there's, if you've never gone and watched one of his movies, you've got to see at least some of the famous scenes, like his fight in the mall in Police Story with all of his crazy stunts is fucking crazy. Like, the level of perfection that he hits when performing stunts, the storytelling of just physicality and combat is the kind of thing that just blows my mind. It's superb. Ah, fuck yeah. Fuck yeah.
Gibby's hype.
I'm fucking hyped for Jackie Chan movies.
We've been skirting around this the entire time, but let's talk about the impact of kung fu movies on like American cinema and just American media mostly.
Yeah,
because like, holy crap. We already talked about Matrix, Kill Bill, Jackie Chan Adventures.
I was watching fucking Venture Brothers the other day with Henchman 21 in a karate dojo trying to train the children to be the next henchman. And he's talking to a six-year-old of just like, he like smacks him on the face, just like, how did that make you feel? And the kid's like, smacks him again. Don't think, feel. He starts quoting Enter the Dragon of like, like a finger touching the moon, and the other sensei comes in like, Gary, they're six. You can't hit the children. They're six. but they should feel. Think about the finger and the moon. Get out.
Good.
It's everywhere.
It's everywhere.
All at once.
Yeah, there it is.
I'm bad.
We did this episode already and I wasn't here for it.
Like, the influence of kung fu is in anime. It's in cartoons. Like, every cartoon you watched on Cartoon Network, Nickelodeon, and Toon Disney at one point or another had some sort of training sequence where everybody's wearing a gi and they're having to like focus on learning a move or something, whether it was for comedy or if it was for serious. Everybody does that. There's always the sensei, the mentor figure. There's always the teacher. Like, it's in every single cartoon that you've watched, sometimes more extensively, like Avatar, sometimes just as a brief joke, like in SpongeBob. Like, it's there, and you might not even realize it.
Gibby, something you asked me, when we first were talking about, like, hey, how do we tackle this? Or is this something we'll make an episode about? It was like, hey, why do all my black friends like kung fu movies?
A significant amount of my black male friends of an age between 20 and 35 have an attachment to kung fu movies. And I was just like, what's the most polite way for me to ask this question without going like I tried to be very specific and not just go, why do black guys like kung fu movies, in the same way that like, why do black guys like Dragon Ball Z?
So kung fu movies, as we've stated already, were like a separation from Wuzhai, which are all very much so mythical Chinese mythology, like same kind of Greek mythology, Hercules, demigod stories like that. And Kung Fu was, what if we took quote unquote every man whose only real quality were their ass kickers?
Yeah.
And made movies about these guys. And during that same time, movies like Enter the Dragon, you know, late 70s, early 80s, that was the same time blaxploitation movies were being created. And now I think that has like a negative context, but in the time it was the very much so the for us, by us, we're making movies about black people, for black people, right, type media. And a lot of them saw that and were like, hey, what if we do that? One of the actors from Enter the Dragon, Jim Kelly, was one of the biggest ones. He was in a ton of movies.
I could tell because
Black
when I watched
Belt
it,
Jones and Black Samurai.
When I watched it, I was just like, "You've done this before. You know exactly what you're supposed to do."
He was a martial artist. He knew Bruce Lee.
Yeah.
And after that, they started cranking out movies. The most prolific kind of movie of that style, of that idea, Shaft.
Yeah.
You've at least heard
Shaft.
Hell yeah.
So much so that we've even parodied blaxploitation kung fu movies with Black Dynamite, which is moi.
What a show.
Chef's kiss. Please, dear listener, do yourself a favor. Go watch the Black Dynamite movie and then watch a couple episodes of the Adult Swim Black Dynamite TV show.
One of the funniest lines in any movie I've ever heard was when he says something like, I'm coming back so I can clean up the community and get drugs out of my community and stop the dealers who are selling drugs to my community. And the other actor goes, but Black Dynamite, I sell drugs to the community.
He has a pimp named Cream Corn. And he raises kids at the orphanage.
Oh,
his orphanage pimp house combination.
Oh, Lord.
I love that movie.
A self-fulfilling prophecy. But like, but it's really cool to me that like at a time in our culture that was pretty pivotal, you know, late 60s, early 70s to a lot of the media that we see today, that like we saw a combination of two very different cultures from two parts of the world, and like they meshed so
very
well.
Right,
that's so cool to me.
Yeah, I mean, and it's timeless, right? The hero's journey, where it's just like you're quote-unquote every man, and he punch and kick real good and he saved the girl, right?
Yeah.
Always a classic, right? It always works.
Especially because Kung Fu, and I'm going to turn this into the mildest tangent on martial arts in general. Like,
okay,
Kung Fu has a lot of influence of not just the everyman, but the everyman who doesn't want to pick the fight. The everyman who's smaller than the bad guy. Not like as ripped as like Jackie Chan and Bruce Lee were, like, a lot of times it's like the Bugs Bunny conundrum. They have incredible power, but they don't pick the fight. They just end the fight. And
because ultimately Kung Fu is self-defense.
Yeah. Many martial arts, going back to like the inception of things like judo, you see that they are practiced and perfected by guys who are smaller than the premier athlete, by the bullies. There's a phenomenal documentary on YouTube called Fighting in the Age of Loneliness that goes back to the small men that became the masters of judo and influenced all of martial arts in the modern world. Because if you practiced enough using your body that's not as powerful as somebody else's, you can defeat any foe that comes for you with skill and technique rather than just pure muscle. And that's everywhere in a lot of the Kung Fu movies that we see today. And I love that they carry on that spirit and that tradition.
And arguably, these are one of the few places that, as American media is being introduced to Hong Kong and then vice versa, when things get imported, there's still a lot of really shitty, like, prejudice and stereotype in America about the just feminization of Asian men. Mm-hmm. And so these are examples where, just because they are not big, buff, and tall like Arnold Schwarzenegger, does not mean that they cannot do what constitutes manly things, so to speak. Mm-hmm. Like, that it is very much a reclamation of what the male Asian body is capable of in media. Mm-hmm. And especially the fact that, like, again, like, a lot of, like, Bruce Lee went to America and he kept getting, like, he kept getting the short stick, basically, was just kind of supporting things, like, wasn't really landing any work and was constantly discriminated against. Goes back to Hong Kong. Like, that is where his career takes off. And then suddenly, like, American audiences are infatuated with these movies that American studios never wanted to write because they couldn't get their heads out of their asses, basically.
I feel like, going on, like, your thing of masculinity, I feel like the same kind of douchebag wannabe Giga Chad, who has, like, a Scarface poster in his room, is also always trying to use the Bruce Lee "be like water" quote.
Right.
You are not water. You are, like, a cup that keeps getting shaken up over and over again and getting splashed out.
Your warm glass of Four Loko.
Got him!
Is it Four Loko or is it piss? We'll never know.
I don't know which one's more dangerous for consumption, and I'm too scared to find out if it's the original recipe Four Loko or not.
No, they're not cool enough to be the original recipe.
Lord.
Yeah, so closing thoughts.
The other
thoughts,
thing, huh? I was going to say, kind of a closing thought segue. What I've really enjoyed about this deep dive and history lesson, like, mini history for me, is, like, one, realizing, like, this is one of our, like, longest running forms of action movie that values humor at the same time as it does choreography.
Yeah.
Because I absolutely agree. I feel like Indiana Jones is one of the few American franchises that does that, but then there aren't too many that I can think of that
Star
aren't
Wars
inspired
sometimes.
By kung fu movies.
Yeah.
That are
there's that not a lot that are good
with like that are juggling both of those things at the same time well. But also that, like, so much of the structure and genre and modus operandi of kung fu movies is all about passing down what has come before and not trying to, like, pretend that we're not doing that. Like, Kung Fu Hustle, every other scene from that movie comes from something else, whether it's, like, old Chinese or Hong Kong films or from America, like, and they're not trying to hide where those inspirations come from. And it's incredible. And it's part of the storytelling, is constantly going back to what has come before us, what can we do differently, or what are we trying to continue to make a part of this conversation? Or, like, is this thing still the most important thing, or can it just be a nod and let's focus on this element instead? And then watch what happens 10 years later when the next guy picks that up and goes, hey, what can we do with this? And the torch just continues to get passed on, which is really exciting. Because, again, American media doesn't do that, because we like to stick our heads in the sand and complain about copywriting and who's stealing whose material. Because, God, if that ain't the American way, that what's going to outlast us all in the apocalypse is going to be fucking copyright holding. I swear to you.
Absolutely.
But it's exciting to see a genre that has these traditions and values and is continuously trying to share and reinvent and honor what's come before it and what it can use for the next movies that are going to come after it.
Yep. Gibby?
There's a lot of fucking good kung fu movies out there. Here's, reader, what you should do. Reader. Fuck, what am I on? Like,
reader, if you're reading the transcript
If you're reading
podcast.
The transcript that we have not put out ever before. But watch a bunch of kung fu movies, specifically ones like Enter the Dragon, Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon, which is something we didn't even like get to talk about, mm-hmm. but it fucking
Shout
rules.
Out to Jet Li.
The Ip Man movies, basically any Jackie Chan movie before like the year 2010. Watch all of those, enjoy them, and then go watch Kung Pao Enter the Fist, which is the funniest stupid movie that has ever existed. The lines in that movie are immaculate. Just Wimp Low going, "I'm bleeding, making me the victor."
We trained him wrong because it was funny.
We trained him wrong on purpose as a joke. That is one of the greatest
parodies.
How do
you like my face to foot style?
And his feet squeak whenever he runs away.
No. Oh my
Hilarious.
God.
Hilarious. That's all I really have to say. Like, watch a bunch of them. Watch Kung Pao. Exceptional.
Speaking of recommends, if you are like me and you enjoy YouTube rabbit holing through other people's video essays, a channel that I very much enjoy digging into for this is called Accented Cinema.
They
cover so much Asian media and Asian representation in American media. So if you've not already subscribed to them or listened to their stuff, go binge a couple handful of videos, because that's what I did
Accented Cinema
for this
rules.
Episode. They do fantastic work. Go subscribe. They're not even at 500,000 subscribers.
Bullshit.
Which is criminal. Which is very criminal. For me, man, listen, if you've consumed media, if you've looked at something, kung fu movies had some kind of impact. Tekken, Mortal Kombat, Street Fighter, Kill Bill, Batman, Matrix, John Wick, every fucking John Woo film. All of them all have their roots in kung fu movies. Just go grab a drink, grab some buds, and just like watch dudes punch each other in the face. It's a great time.
Fuck yeah. And
not
kick.
Jacked dudes
and
still
elbow
punching
and
each other
and
in
chop
the face.
And crane kick.
If you want a good comedy, is again Kung Pao, one of the best. Kung Pao, Shaolin Soccer, mm-hmm. and Kung Fu Hustle are
good
like
picks.
So good.
Any Kung Jackie Fu, Chan oh. movie where he says, "I don't want any trouble," while he's holding either a vase or a baby. Sometimes
I'm sorry.
Both.
Sometimes both.
Sometimes both, maybe. But that is a good time.
Please. I said, I don't want trouble.
This has been this episode of the Liberal Artist Podcast. Thank you so much for joining us. Join us next time when we start the Kung Fu School the way of Dark Brandon.
We don't know where we are, Jack, but we're about to kick ass.
I don't even know who I am.
Peace.
The Liberal Artists Podcast premieres every other Thursday on your favorite podcasting platform. The show is hosted by Bodio Papula, Kaylie Horowitz, and Andy Gibson. You can find the show at LibArtistsPod on Instagram and Twitter. Thanks to White Hot for performing the theme song Reflect, which can be found on freebeats.io. Now, I'm off to go exploring, and maybe, maybe, just maybe, I'll find a sheep that I can call my own. Good day.
Holy crap, that's that, and I didn't even realize.
That's Gibby punching his mic because he got too excited.
Ha!
Oh!
I sure did. No, I just went, I made my pop filter go pop.
Pop goes the filter.
Pop, pop!
Pop, pop!